This will be the last month for 2015. For those who don't know me, my name's Ben Smith. I'm the convener of the Inner Design Forum of WA. Also, welcome to this space tonight, which has been generously made available by the Brickworks Design Studio. And if you haven't already, you should avail yourself of some of the promotional material and samples around the space because brick is a wonderful thing. And maybe we should be using much more of it too, so here's the plan. Each year, the PDO Urban Design Forum closes with a history lesson, so to speak. As planners and designers, we often reflect on the decisions, the ideas, the inspiration, the logic that underpin a lot of our great places. What was, for example, the idea behind the axial design of Fremantle? How did the garden city plan of Menora and Coolvilla actually respond to the site? The design process that underpins great places is far too often lost with time because it's not documented, and sadly the generations that were the architects or the planners of those places perhaps are no longer with us as well. Imagine if we could ask Hope and Clem about Coolvilla. What the Urban Design Forum, however, is very interested in doing is ensuring that we do have these conversations with the designers and managers of the places that have been built in recent history. In other words, all the generations are still here. So tonight, we'll be hearing about the East Perth Redevelopment Project. Or rather, perhaps we should say the third East Perth Redevelopment Project. If one remembers that originally it was market gardens, then it became residential in the 19th century, then it became industrial in the post-war war period, and then it turned to a mixed use residential commercial precinct that we see today. So tonight we will hear from the horse's mouth how a lot of the plans that are in the East Perth Redevelopment Project, how they occurred, and we'll hear that from EPRA's, I think, principal planner at the time. Yeah, close enough, I'll say that. It's on the CV these days, or shouldn't it? I'd like to introduce Charles to you. Actually, Charles being the Institute's immediate past president, I don't think he really requires an introduction, but I will give him a short one nonetheless. Charles Johnson has had a background in urban design, also in urban geography and town planning, nearly 35 years experience working at local and state government levels. From 1988 to 1994, he was planning manager on the East Perth Project. In 1991, he received Winston Churchill Memorial Fellowship to study urban renewal projects in Canada, United States, and Great Britain. He's now established in his own planning consultancy, Planning Context, which has a policy, research, and governance focus. And he's also currently a board member of the Metropolitan Redevelopment Authority. So please could you welcome Charles Johnson for East Perth, the plans that you didn't see.
Thank you. The mic, so if you can't hear, just let me know. Okay, this is a bit of a personal retrospective, but it's also a tribute to a number of the people who have turned up tonight to make sure I don't lie about them. I'll try to do my best to lie. And it's also an opportunity to talk about plans that are now 30 years old. Annalise will remember, of course, the 1985 plans. We're going to talk a bit about that. I was tempted to be very retro and show 35mm slide projections. The high tech of 1988 was to have two slide projectors, and you would have seen those. But the Gen Ys here today would probably wonder how we survived. But we did. Also, I need to do the standard stuff. This is not me as a board member of the MRA or any other role I have. This is just some personal recollections, which probably after 25 or so years is a bit foggy now. So I wanted to take you through this. A lot of slides, a lot of stuff. And so we probably need to hold the questions and interruptions that John Simon and others will make till later. Okay, so if he starts talking, just shut him up for a bit. Okay, so we're underway. I don't know where to point this, but I'll try that. Okay, so I'm talking about the project background, the 85 concepts, the development of the planning, the 1990 plans, and then the 92 EPRA plans, and then probably make some general observations towards the end. So we are moving quickly. Look, we need to acknowledge that the traditional owners, the Noongar people, use this area. East Perth was very much, I'll try it. I'll use this separate. East Perth, right through these series of lakes up here were fresh water. And the Noongar people camped right in here, and they were camping in that area right up until the 1980s. European settlement sort of started to squeeze them in, started to infill the lakes, contaminate the water systems, changed a lot of that for them. We did get Aboriginal clearance under the Section 18, 1991, but we were on the basis that we continued a dialogue with the Aboriginal, with the Noongar Nation on this area. And it was pretty fair to say it was a divided view. Some people said, look, this is rubbish now, this is an old industrial site, and you might as well go on and develop it. But others said, this is another stab in our culture, and you're taking away more. So we never really resolved that. We did a major, Aboriginal art pieces, and we also dedicated an area for friendship. So we tried as much as we can within the context of the day. So, but it was always a bit controversial, that whole issue. Many of you won't remember this, but East Perth was a slum. It was an industrial backwater where all the wires and pipes and everything went to. It was a very contaminated site. See the gasworks. See the gasworks up here. That's what it looked like in the 1940s, 30s. The power station, of course, we still haven't solved that problem. A lot of industrial, a lot of land use is contaminated. This is the main drain. That's SEQA, the State Energy Commission, trying to cover up the contamination of the main drain back in the 1980s. So it was a site that was really the east end of town. It was the poor place that no one wanted to invest in, no one wanted to go to. Good old Gordon Stevenson in the 1950s, and this is his plan, 1955 plan, wanted a road around here, a road through here, and a new bridge across the river. This is the railway. So there was another bridge plan to do that. That was the 55 plan. Of course, as great planners, of course, we take all the complexity of land use and put it into zoning. And this was all industrial, so we simplified and all the landscape. And so the 55 plan, sort of started to set the planning for this. But this is a beauty. The next one is truly wonderful. This is the 1963 Metropolitan Regents Deck. Look at this. This collar around the central Perth would have choked it to death if we hadn't built it. And this is the MRS now, with the downgrading of the foreshore. Of course, these black areas are the work of the MRA at the moment. Alignment through here. So a very different planning framework. But the 55 plan, or the 63 metro plan, set the main roads off on a frenzy of buying land for a future freeway. They got very excited about building a bridge across the river. Later, were very upset when we wanted to move, or Annalise wanted to move. The East Perth project, by the early 1980s, Parliament had decided to move for the City Northern Bypass, it was called. The planning blight was really starting to recognise. There was a lot of stuff, you know, the stuff that planners and main roads had built and bought, and it was pretty messy. Terry Burke, who was Brian Burke's brother, was the member for Perth. He was appointed to chair the East Perth Land Use and Landscape Committee. Verity Allen, many of us will remember Verity Allen, who sadly passed away, but Verity was the executive, and the project was led by the Urban Lands Council, and then Land Bank, and then Land Corp, and it was charged with trying to look at the interim and long-term uses of East Perth. And their plans that they produced in 1985 to 90 period. So this is a schematic of the 1990 plan. The Claisebrook, beautiful living stream, and the bridge across to Burswood, the rail bridge here, and the redevelopment, this concept of this. So this was probably one of the first, I think, comprehensive redevelopment projects, concept planning in Perth. I may be wrong, but January 1985, the project officially got into existence. Tony Shrapnel was the project manager. Annalise was the assistant. From March 85, they wrote and published a series of reports on the situation in East Perth. And they used national expertise. They produced some 19 reports, and they used social planners, economists. It was quite out there in terms of what they were trying to do at the time. And it really tried to produce an integrated plan of East Perth. This was the heart, the sort of major development, but also looking at this North Bridge where they had the City Northern bypass links. Aberdeen, through there, and the bridge across the river. So this plan, they have gurus, as we like to have, gurus from over east, and it considered what was going to happen in this area. It prepared three concepts, and they addressed different levels of intervention. The most dense was about 1,430 dwellings. The most important thing I want you to note is that 33% of those dwellings in 1985 were to be social housing. So that plan, and that was a mandate of that committee, was to produce social housing as a significant proportion. So that was some of the planning there. The Claisebrook, and we have this rather understated road going through here. Looks like a bit of a boulevard, but secretly I think main roads had a bit of a different idea about what a boulevard might look like. Closer to a freeway than most of us would see. But as it showed here, the freeway was to come across at Claisebrook, south of Claisebrook, and over the Constitution Hill, out over to Northbridge. By this time, of course, if you've noticed on Burswood, main roads were busily stockpiling soil for the landing of this bridge. They were very excited about having a bridge and building something spectacular. And this thing that would looking like something like a minor road that disguises, or a freeway disguised as a minor road. For those who are involved in the Lend Lease project down at the Causeway, this is the concept at the time. This was a water park, water gardens. This is the Causeway, and the water gardens where we're now seeing, of course, the Lend Lease project coming out of the ground. So there were different ideas at the time. The future of Northbridge was a key sort of discussion. Annalise has said a bit to me about that, and the idea there was that we would operate a one-way pier in Newcastle and Aberdeen through here until such times as, and it was yet to be 15 years, I think, that you would need to bowl over all the properties between Aberdeen and Newcastle to build a freeway. And there was a serious debate at the MRD at the time of whether it was better to bowl over the housing, this is in the 1980s, whether it was better to bowl over the housing now and grind it, or leave the housing. Annalise did some major designs, and I remember those sketches you did to try to show how this could be recycled and kept alive. But that was a serious debate that we were having at the time about whether we would just bowl this, get rid of this for the freeway. But imagine that now. How far would that debate? It would make Row 8 look like a tea party. The plans for East Perth, they advertised, which they got 350 submissions. The preferred option was a higher density scenario, and you can see that with the density here. This is the part of the Claisebrook inlet through here and the road going through here. They haven't sort of decided how that would finally work. And there were some 1,400 of dwellings. It is estimated that it would cost about $30 million. And they sent that off to Cabinet, I think, in about 87. My memory's a bit gone. But went to Cabinet. Cabinet, you've got to remember, Cabinet at that day and the time was WA Inc. It was the time of the WA Development Corporation, who's Carl Curtis. It was the time of doing deals, it was the time of the America's Cup, it was the time that government can play in land development. And so the decisions, and I think from what I understand, and the police might, with a couple of drinks later, tell you that it probably was the issue of the social housing that killed it, and the cost. So the decision was to not abandon the project, but to drop the plans. And what they decided to do was to send it off to ask Landcorp to make it cost neutral. And so we spent the next 5 years trying to prove this thing was cost neutral, which is impossible. But anyway, so that was the 85 plan. The other big decision that came at the time was critical. The issue was that this is the freeway reserve, so that little minor road you saw through the pram, you know, when you look at what the reserve is much bigger. And so the idea was to move this to join it up there. Very simple. That allowed this planning area to be part of the city, not an isolated piece of work. The project team and Annalise, just before she went over east, I think, was working with the team on that. And they recognised they needed the bypass. They recognised that the MRD had purchased, they had afforded us to purchase all this land in here. And so the MRD had acquired that property, and so we had to look at that. They were not happy. They were not happy. But the East Perth project, mainly through the efforts of Neil Stevens, made a lot of people unhappy. So they were not problem. But I may be wrong. Landcorp managed the project in 88. They brought in this guy called Michael Radcliffe, who's appointed from Victoria. I took over from Annalise. Annalise ran over east, I think. Verity Allen remained on the project. Terry Burke retired from politics. He was the member of Perth. And then in 1990, we had this coup that got rid of the last czar of the MRPA. Then David Hatt and Michael Radcliffe moved, and the project moved over to there, but we were very grateful for the patience of Langle. Tell them that, Carl, during that period, because the project ate up a lot of money and wasn't looking like it was going to go anywhere during that period. We started our site analysis doing some testing, some works, and just checking on all the good work that the 85 plant had done, looking at the industrial stuff and saying, what the hell? We started to develop the first concept plans. And I've got to say, this first period up until 1990 was dominated by architects. It was dominated by the building and the landscape, and this is some of the first ones that was here. We were starting to negotiate for this thing called an AMTC, Advanced Manufacturing Training Technology Centre, which is tough. And we were looking at that and all the sort of buildings and the landscape. But the style was very much this big building style of the, you know, Silver City and all that through this end. You see this crack? That's actually a crack in my slide. You know, those were some of the early concept, and this plan, as some of you here would nod, Andy would remember this plan very much. This is the Forbes and Fitzharding plan of that time, and you can see the big building and the landscape, the design, and the starting to think about a screen through that western end of the... So this was 88, 89 sort of concepts for us. This was an important plan that came out of the 85 stuff, and we're sitting around looking at this thinking, Jesus, it looks like it could be an opportunity for an inlet. And this plan sort of shows that the topography was naturally there. This all this soil through here is all dug stuff, not only contaminated, it was very, very difficult to pile. And so we started to think about an inlet, and we started to do some designs. This was one of the first open circular, very, and you've got to remember that the time was very conservative. It was, we had commercial advisors telling us to subdivide this for single residential housing. So this is quite a conservative sort of, you know, townhouse look to this plan that we've never seen before, I hope. This showed sort of like a racking around here of townhouses and a soft sort of inlet approach with some development on the northern side of the inlet. But the first sort of plans that were done by Oakman and Zerdewald. And then Perrin Rosenthal did some plans for us. So we'd been architect shop, and you know, Michael Ratcliffe, most of you know, liked the architect shop. And so we got a lot of different designs, and this one, Perrin Rosenthal. Perrin Rosenthal had been doing a lot of, resort stuff over in the Eastern States, and so we saw here sort of resort-looking different styles coming down the hill. They started to form up the inlet. This was the triangle site, which was one of the earlier thinking ones, and there's bits of hay park still there. So, and we started to do some images of what this looked like. So during that period, there was sort of different ideas, different ways that this could be developed, and different. We were searching for what would work. We did a lot of financial assessment to try and prove that this thing would fly. None of it did. But we tried to show how it financially would work. A lot of smart people, John Allison from Lancourt today, and everyone tried to find out how we could persuade the government that this thing was cost neutral. Tall order. We also did a lot of project delivery, and we sort of were doing a lot of stuff about how the project management would go, how would we deliver this stuff. So not beyond the planning, how to deliver. I don't know why I didn't keep them, but Neil Stevens did some great Gantt chart. Neil was working for project planning and management at that time. Some brilliant longer-term strategy of how things would work together. But so project management we were starting to look at. All right, City of Perth. I can still remember the day, and I think Andy was with me, maybe, I can't remember, but we walked into Rob Heather's office, the chief planner of the City of Perth, and said, these are our visions, these are our designs, and we want to change the way we do planning in the city. We want to do mixed use, we want to change that, we want to get away from zoning, we want to do all these wonderful things. And just remember, you've got to remember that Perth in the 80s was twice as boring as it is now. So you've got to remember that there was nothing in St. George's Terrace. And, you know, they gave bonuses for building boring forecourts. You could get a 10% bonus on your height by doing one of these things and putting a lovely piece of artwork or something in front. So we sort of challenged them a bit about how we would do the planning for this. We said we wanted mixed use. Rob basically threw us out and said that we'd never do it and the city should control it and we would go through the normal planning processes. That for me stuck in my mind as a day of a declaration of that the authority was going to, we hadn't even thought of the authority, so this was 1989. So we were saying we are not happy and we are going to make this happen over your dead bodies. Okay. I was involved with a movement, City Vision, in those days, really trying to argue city living. We had to get people living down. No one lived downtown. And I've got to tell you that the whole property market and everyone was saying, you'll never build high density, you'll never build. Just do suburbia, and it'll be fine. So there was a whole movement at that time to start to argue about changing the city. And the redevelopment, we were interested in a lot of these ideas that came along. One of the things that then happened was sometime in 88, 89, we started to put all these plans together on a wall. It was a day, I don't know if you remember, but we tried to look at all these architects' ideas, and we had these various architects who had done different parts of the project, and we tried to put it together, and this was one sort of interpretation of what they looked like. And we thought, oh, shit, this is really not looking good. So we decided then that we really had to commission a coordinated master plan. But it was still going to be the architect, God architect. Any architects here? Yeah, lots of them. So God architects still reigned, and Philip Cox. And Philip Cox, of course, the God architect in Australia at the time. So, you know, we employed them to do it. any of you remember, how many of you remember the multifunction polis? Yeah, good. Multifunction polis was an idea that every copy of this document was torn up, but I still had a couple of slides. So this was something that started back about 85, I think. It was an idea between 87 and 80. Japanese government, Australian government, wanted to do a collaboration about a new city or an idea for a very mixed city, which was innovative, was education, was lifestyle. And of course, good Australians, we read that as a Japanese enclave in Australia. And so everyone got very... But we had actually been involved. We had prepared some of the plans and we were part of the WA bid. The minister of the day pulled our bid out the day before it had to be submitted because there was all this money sort of supposed to be behind the plan. And so we pulled it. We were part of one of, it wasn't just one site in Western Australia, we had a number of sites. The bid was actually won by Queensland. Queensland government got nervous, pulled out, and ended up at Mawson Lakes in South Australia. Because the South Australians would take anything. They're desperate. So this ended up there, sort of, and it sort of petered out by about, 1990. So it was but it was there, and we were involved in those plans. Then in October of 1990, by then, we had our grand vision. this plan was the outline or the development plan of the time. It was released by Carmen Lawrence on the banks of the Sorrel in October of 1990. She, you know, the government of that day, you know, this was heading into a recession. The government of the day needed some blue sky. Doesn't that sound familiar? And so they had gone through a series of premiers frequently, and it was the end of that era. And so Carmen sort of grabbed onto this. We had made all sorts of promises about its financial viability. We said it would break even if you did everything. So this was the sort of basic concept with the inlet, the joint bridge, a whole lot of development happened here, and this is a great little plan. This is the architect, you know, sort of vision of development, in the landscape we had, of course, the feature of the inlet and development around the inlet, the triangle site, over towards the Tate site, and then you had all this development, this huge development up here around the gasworks, the power station. This is the gasworks. So it was a very sort of optimistic future. A product of the, late 80s, this was the grand vision of a plan. None of us thought it would financially work, but we said that. We did a lot of nice illustrations. We still haven't solved the power station. It's still sitting there. Anyone wants to buy it, give us a yell, sell it. We had a lot of images, because images is really all we had to show fairly modest densities and development and activity around it. So there's some. The inlet itself, I just wanted to explain, the inlet was there for about four different reasons. One was to change the perceptions of East Perth. You've got to remember that East Perth at that time was a dump. It was an industrial landscape. No one would ever invest a cent in there. The real estate people were telling us, it's not going to work. Forget it. And we wanted to also recognise the site conditions, as a lot of the work has been done through this area, that you needed to pile for 18 or 24 metres or whatever. But it was very expensive to build anything in there, and you're basically going to turn it into a landscape. And also, the main drain itself, we did some testing on the main drain. The main drain's a mess. You know, if you talk about a living stream, you wouldn't be able to get your kids playing it. There was a lot of raw sewage. There was a lot of contamination flowing down that thing. So it wasn't really viable to leave it on the surface and call it a spring. And the most important thing was to force the issue of cleaning up the gasworks site. We've got to get back to the gasworks site. But the gasworks site was a core issue, how we were going to resolve that. So those were the three things there. We did a lot of sort of initial planning for relocate utilities. Remember, this is the wires and pipes were all going through this area, so there was a lot of work needed underground to relocate stuff. The slides aren't really. The plan itself was optimistic. It had a lot more office. It had a lot more, and you see in the red there, commercial research. We'd sort of thought that around the same TC that we'd have a lot of commercial activities. What we ended up with the ABC certainly. And then we also didn't have a lot of residential dwellings in this. It was mainly, that was to pump up the numbers so it looked better commercially. So that was the 1990 plan. We also did in that plan how we proposed to implement it. And we were talking, you know, we briefed Cabinet and we talked about the analysis. We talked about the need to assemble the land, do a new type of scheme, how we would the legislation might work to support that. We had some opposition to that 1990 plan led by Ian Alexander. Ian Alexander was the member of Perth, very left-wing. He wanted the old 33% public housing. This thing didn't even mention public housing. No mention of public housing at all. So that was it. Oh, the other decision which was made at that time, we did not trust the MRA. MRD. Sorry, Brett. MRD. And we always thought that they were going to have a rearguard action to take back the road reserve. Because we were on a knife's edge. We never knew from week to week whether the project would be shut down by the government. Because it was costing a lot of money. And Langport and then the Department of Works were paying for that. So we decided, and we got some federal government money to build this thing. We built it here. And because we had moved into the Department of Planning, we got them to approve it in a road reserve. So that was deliberately done to stop the MRD from ever thinking about taking back their road reserve, because we're building a new TAFE in that. So that killed off the road reserve. Then there was the committee established in the 1990s, which Michael Ratcliffe was very much involved in, I think John was involved in, to look at the options of taking the road north, how it would work, and there were two. They finally, I think, reported about 1993, and there were two options. One was a tunnel, and the other was this one-way pier. And they recommended the tunnel, and the government eventually decided to do the tunnel. Thank God. As the authority, we were after this stuff. We were after all the stuff on the top, because we wanted them to play with. So it was a great result. So the moving the development of the Greater Farmer Freeway. As was said, Peter said, I was very fortunate getting a Churchill Fellowship to go and study urban renewal overseas. I went to Portland. We were very much into trying to explain things by showing what had happened elsewhere. So Portland, you know, still being the pin-up for many years of ours. Public art, this was the introduction to public art, and we took back some. This is my favourite public art image here. This guy's a troll under a bridge. He's got a V dub. Yeah, great piece of public artwork. That's an offer. In Beaver, Portland. So, yeah, public art, and that's where we got the idea. We were thinking that public art was going to be pretty important in this process. False Creek in Vancouver was very instrumental in our thinking about how to revitalise something. And the British Urban Development Corporation's caught our attention. This was the Thatcher government, big brother over local authorities in England. And they built, you know, there's about 10 of them. I visited quite a few of them. They had all the powers that we were seeking. So that became a model. So the London Docklands, the Bristol, all of the time where all of the development corporations, we looked at their powers. And that's what we were interested in. Not that we were trying to replicate Canary Wharf idea, but we looked very much at the past. From that point, we started to get real about the project and started to refine it. Certainly the Act of Parliament was presented to Parliament in 1991, but wasn't sort of proclaimed until July 1, 1992. And that had extraordinary powers and unprecedented. No one else in Australia at that time, or still apart from the other redevelopment authorities, has this. The Land Assembly, government and private, we'll talk about Land Assembly, the planning powers to take away the local and the state government planning powers. The public works, we could act as a public works agency. So we had all the ability to march in and do public works. We had commercial operations. We could sell and trade in land. And we had set up a board, a seven-person board to run it. Of course, we had the administration to support it. 1991, we started to look more seriously about what it would look like. We basically abandoned the northern part. We said that bloody power stations is just too bloody hard. we'll leave that for the MRA with its hand trying to still do it. So we will concentrate on the inlet. We set up a three-day design. I wouldn't call it a charrette, but it was a design exercise. We started at that time, I think we went from really having an architectural mentality to an urban design mentality. And we brought in a guy called Greg Dees from the NCDC, and we had a lot of input from some of the top planners around, or architects, and we ran this workshop. We dismantled their previous plans and put them back together. We produced a number of options. This one has a sort of like canal up the gasworks site and another island here, different configurations through here. But this style of architecture and style of urbanism that started to emerge through this planning exercise was pretty important in 1991. We had a core team of planners, very cool set. There's some young people here. That's Tony Watson. That's an Alan Stewart. Where's Alan? There's Eric. He still looks young. That guy in there, very cool, drinking BB out of a can, Andrew Howard, and Scott Bird. And there was a whole lot of other people that were more civilised and didn't appear in the photographs. But this was, that was taken at the opening event. And there was a great team of people. And everyone was sort of equal. And we were all trying to deal with the macerations of Michael Ratcliffe. And so we were all sort of working our way through the project. So we had a great team. A lot of those people have gone on to be, like Neil Stevens, John Syme, Scott Bird, a whole lot of people that have really developed careers. Of course, I'm running a micro planning firm from the backyard of my house. So, some people did really well. Not me. But they were a great team, and it was a multidisciplinary team. And everyone was equal. So Pip Sawyer, for example, was the public artist. And if you know Pip Sawyer, she would not be quiet during these design sessions. So all of this stuff was very multidisciplinary, and it was great. And we had a broader, there was a whole lot of other engineers, so I'm always worried about every time I see experts, everyone claims to be involved. Yes, you all were. I just put this up, listener. I've got it in the book. So the 91-92 indicative development plan was there, and we started to advertise that as we moved towards after the redevelopment authority was underway. I won't go back to that because we advertised it, and the issues, we weren't really interested in what people had to say, but we advertised it anyway. These people up here on this hill were very upset with the potential loss of films. This Arden Street was in the hands of the City of Perth. One of the things we never got hold of, Arden Street, though, the city decided not to develop based on the views of the people up here that didn't want to lose their views, the private landowners. But we were out there consulting, not in a meaningful way, but we did some public meetings. And listened and then went on our merry way. I'm being honest, that's what it was about. We showed a lot of images of what we were about at the time. This was a brilliant... we wrote a town planning scheme basically in 6 months and got it gazetted. From the creation of the authority, maybe we started a bit earlier, but we, Andy and... everyone worked on this to get this planning scheme, a new planning scheme that had no zoning. So there was no zoning in this thing. It had preferred and contemplated uses. We had a big argument about keeping the archives. I wanted to throw it out, but the government felt, no, we'll just have to have something to develop it. The real estate people would not know what to do unless you had an R in front of it. So we kept that. We had quite a bit of developer contributions from there. Promotion of mixed-use development, we were providing incentives. We used a lot of policies and considerable discretion. So this is a very flexible system. When I look back on it, the bloody thing is only this thing. You look at a planning scheme now and you're just desperate to. Yeah. So the policy document had the plans and plans in it here. The urban village public art policies all cut through. No affordable housing strategy. Not until later. And we did quite a bit of work because we were always on a knife edge. We never knew whether the government was going to sort of say the inlets can't afford it, can't do it. So we produced these red herrings. This is one of them. This was what it would look like if we didn't build the inlet. So we had a bit of a lake and a couple of lakes on it, and underground and a little of the street. So we were doing all these sort of plans to say really the government, what a stupid idea if you don't build the inlet. But we were trying to survive. We were trying to persuade them that this was worth doing. And we would do anything that we had to make sure that happened. Our godsend was the Building Better Cities program. Brian Howe came along. Got to remember, this was also the time of, I'll mention that in a minute. But we got $32 million from the federal government. And that was announced December 1991. The money came through in the middle of 2000. We were in the right place at the right time. That money allowed us to build the inlet and get on with the project. And that was essential in terms of that. We had a number of performance targets. One of them was about affordable housing, somewhere buried in there. Michael Radcliffe, we said, well, politically, we're not going to build any affordable housing until the late end of the project. We're going to just do housing, market housing, and then bring affordable housing. We did a deal with Homes West, who owned land in there, and they produced, started with the cooperative housing bond. Look, Building Better Cities was a great initiative. Not only it provided money, but it got the best designers and best people in Australia looking at it. Ever get a chance to look at this series of publications across there? So there's about 8 or 10 of these during the 90s. This was the first time we ever came across new urbanism. First time, you know, traditional neighbourhood design. This was back in the early 90s. So these publications, and we participated in them, were very important. God, I wish that we could do that sort of thing now. I wish we could repeat that. I had some hopes when we had the Cities Unit and, you know, Infrastructure Australia, but, you know, alas and woe. Maybe the new Prime Minister might help. You've got to remember that this was Paul Keating's, the recession we had to have. This was the time that the project became a works project. It became a project to generate employment. And this is of that time.
Kim Beasley.
For those who remember, that's Michael Radcliffe. That's what he looks like. We were actually about that employment generation. These people were just throwing rocks and doing stuff along the foreshore. Was that one of your management ones? Yeah. No. I wouldn't have said rocks in. We started building the inlet. I still remember, and we started to do the environmental plans, because the Act didn't exempt us from environmental clearances. So we started doing this, Scott Bird and ourselves, and I can still remember getting phone calls from the EPA executive saying, you realise you don't have an approval to build the inlet? And I said, yeah. And I go off and talk to Neil Stevens, and I said, what are you doing, Neil? And he said, well, tell them we're just moving soil around the site. We were building the inlet. I think the giveaway was with limestone and stuff. So we were building this thing, approvals or not. It was just going to happen. We made mistakes. This is one of the ones that, this thing here. We panicked. There was a gorgeous bridge guys who remember the building, Plain Street, that bridge was so elegant. We were so worried about losing money, continued money from the feds, we caved in and built this little, this thing. That's the Stormwater Overflow. So that little bridge, it's okay, but the design, and I don't have a copy of it, of the bridge, was much nicer. We did a lot of construction underway. We probably moved. This was a real thing. This was a London Pain tree from Trafalgar that we moved to the top of the street. I think it was about $40,000, which is a lot of money, maybe more. This is a famous Neil Stevens story. He was doing work on the Claisebrook main drain, and he managed to collapse some 800 metres of that. Because the plans had shown that it was 3 bricks thick, it was in fact only 1 brick thick. Is that the story, Neil? Is it close enough?
Yeah. So
it's
an emergency event.
Yeah. I know it was quite a few $1,000. Yeah. So that was some of the construction. And then the opening year we'll start getting there. It's a very remembrance for us when we see this was the image, the open slides aren't very good, but now we're seeing this sort of thing. Was the key, so for some of us it's very memorable. And the opening of the inlet in 1994, probably not the sort of affair you'll see in Elizabeth Key with all the rah-rah, but you'll see, we had a good time, a few people were thrown in the water. So that was the opening. Having spent hundreds of, millions of dollars in fixing up under the ground, public art and how it presented was critical. And Nola Farmer and the words there, just read the words. So we were trying to recognise that nature was going to recapture the stream. We had been treating the water with ultraviolet and using it in the stream, using it for landscaping, Nola Farmer. So that nature breakthrough. Public art, the work there was outstanding, it was sent for art. East Perth, ready for business, 1994-95. I want to just spend a couple of minutes talking about breaking eggs. This is how this project actually happened. Land assembly was critical. This is probably the most important plan. Yellow was government ownership. Our problem was getting a hold of that land. The government agencies, some 14 of them, all thought that the land belonged to them somehow, and then they should be paid commercial rates of the day. So it was very important for us to work with Cabinet, we did, and in the legislation, for most sites, with the exception of Sequa and Homes West, I think, and a few others, we got the government to put in the act. You have to transfer the land at historical cost plus 2%. So if it was a Crown grant to you, you got nothing. Yeah, and if you paid for it back then, you bought it like the MRD, you got 2% plus what you paid for. So pretty draconian. If we didn't get the land together, we were never going to go anywhere. So getting the land was critical. So the blue areas were private. We did acquire a couple of private pieces, but not a lot. The gas works was probably the most famous battle that occurred. We spent something towards $2 million proving that Sequa had a big problem. They contaminated not only their site, they contaminated the Swan River, some 6 hectares of it. We started in the negotiations, Sequa were quite happy to sell it to us at commercial rate. Halfway through, they were going to give it to us. In the end, they paid some $14 million or thereabouts. I can't remember the exact numbers. The battles with Sequa and with Bike, with Dr. Rogan and Jachowski were legendary. Neil Stevens versus Dr. Rogan and Jachowski. I remember on a Friday afternoon getting a phone call from a very senior executive at the report at the CEQA, suggesting that Neil Stevens was not a very good person. That he probably had exceeded the decibels of, because these people were yelling. You know, this was not a good, it's not the sort of, and they suggested that Neil should be sent on the next plane back to South Africa. We loved Neil, and Neil was part of that team that, persuaded and in the end won. We threatened to expose them to the EPA. We had done the work. We knew the level of the contaminations. This stuff was contaminating the mussels. This PAHs were highly contaminated. So we blackmailed and we persuaded CEQA at the end. And we won. It was a bitter battle. And it was a great win. The decontamination site, I think that's a young Andy Harris here somewhere, and Scott Bird, the way we did the biomediation and used the old public works depot. Some of the stuff had to be taken to a desert site, some was Red Hill, and some was so the stuff in the river was re-biomediated, dried out, and put back into the gas works. So it was pretty revolutionary. At the time, the cleanup, and this showed the cross sections, how we created this sort of area with a drainage system and membrane to try and do that. And still under the gasworks site, there is quite a bit of stuff that is. But it was all about a risk assessment. Because we could not afford to take all of the soil off the site. Then the landscaping, the gas works, and maintaining that as a public park, being able to sell the other land. The pump station, and this is typical, the pump station in East Perth, major facility that stores sewage. It's a great place for kids now for skating, down the hill with them. But this is typical with our design teams, multi-unit teams of artists and everyone working on this problem. So when we first started working with the Water Corp, they were the usual selves, we want 400 metres setback, and that would have taken out half of Eastbourne. We ended up with 40. We paid for the over, the landscaping, the ceiling. The Water Corp refurbished the whole facility, and it was a great outcome for us. And again, a major negotiation the project did. You can see it, some of the landscape there. And the bridge itself, and Shani Howard designed that was a very special bridge, because it was not only a pedestrian bridge, it was there for the sewage and all the pipes. You might remember that I think it was 1999, a couple of days before Janet Holmes Court was opening the Hatesbury Architects, the art gallery, the pipe burst and polluted the Swan River, polluted the inlet. Keeping a lot of the gardens, the Victoria Gardens, which were really the first botanic gardens of Perth, just moving on, the battles with the City of Perth, we fought, they started with, you can have any pavement as long as it's grey. We wanted urban stone and we wanted to do things differently. The standard lighting, we wanted higher lighting standards. And we wanted, we were trying to deal, they wanted the fence off the inlet. We fought all those battles, won those. Landscape maintained at higher standards, all of those sort of things were part of the deal. Design development, getting the details right and getting ready to sell land, that was something. James Christo and others did some design development around the project to articulate this. We had concepts developed into precinct, provisions developed into guidelines, and when we sold land. So flexibility within divine design envelopes was what we do. A lot of promotion of mixed use and activity. We, in 1992, some of you might remember this, we had a national design competition to show exemplary multi-unit housing development in East Perth. Some 31 entries, a week guaranteed to build at least 5 of them. And so the national winner was the firm from Sydney, Bryce James and Partners. The board threw a fit. These people were doing densities that the board could not cope with. Fortunately for the board, they went bankrupt before they had to actually commit to building these. It was a real shame. We then got Donaldson and Warren and Overmans to do some, what I would call, style was readily accepted in Perth market. So we had a national design competition which resulted in this. Very disappointing. Also, by the time that it all got finished, then I think 95, were the first houses were being built in Mason Street. So that was how not to do a national design competition. recycling historic buildings. Certainly we had the Bowens Warehouse, which we recycled for mixed use. Great interim use of that building was we had the Black Swan Theatre was there for quite some time. That was great. The Glide Street Electricity Substation, the East Perth Primary School. And then there was an issue about how far to go, and we demolished the Brown Street Methodist Church on the day before the Heritage Act came in.
Yeah.
We're still discussing who was responsible for that. I have my theories.
How do you
get
people
to
work on Sunday morning?
Neil organised it. We just haven't decided to pull the trigger. That was something that we decided as an organisation that we were not prepared to risk having that list. So we weren't very nice people. We started to, nothing like the way you sell things today, we didn't use this paper, and set those around about the village and how it would be non-exclusive. Okay. This is John Sine's slide. We started to talk about affordable housing, or in the broader sense of affordable housing, and John worked on this, and led to later a policy on affordable and diverse housing. Now the authority has a minimum of 12%. Most of the early years of the authority and what we were doing, we weren't interested. We gave the Department of Housing the worst sites for in exchange for their top site. So, community facility study, we did some work there. We had the East Perth Primary School. There was a debate about whether we should have a school that was quickly killed, not by me, by others. So it was recycled, but we lost the opportunity to have a school in the area. We talked about community facilities, and mostly we said they'd be provided by the City of Perth elsewhere. City Farm was one of our great little projects, snuck under Michael Radcliffe's nose. A guy called Ruben Cooperman did that, signed them up with... So we had them a very temporary lease. Most of us wanted that to stay, and it's really part of the heritage. So just some conclusions. You can see East Perth, 150 homes, 140 social, sort of affordable, new residents, commercial, workers, government investment, and private sector investment. So that's, I think, pretty impressive from that point of view. It's a product of its time. People who take there now say, look, why don't you make the densities higher? Well, the product around the inlet was that of the day. And we had to keep that in mind. We had to sell within the market. These projects live and die by succeeding. If we had built that inlet and no one bought the bloody property because we had the density from, we wouldn't have been there. I admire what the MRA does now, a lot more place match, place activation, place management, all of those things. So final word is, I think the project was groundbreaking for its day, with a strong vision which set up an inner city housing market that did have a reputable effect. Some analysis I've seen said that the property values have gone up by 25% within sort of 5 or 6 years of the project. Use of multidisciplinary teams was very important. Importance of the Building Better Cities funding, the focus on urban design and public art, the space between buildings. Unique legislation with strong powers succeeded because it got results through its single focus. It was not distracted. It knew it had to deliver and it did. And it led to three other redevelopment authorities and then the MRA. And ladies and gentlemen, that's it. So thank you. I should give the first one.